So, welcome to Interreg part 2. In this part, we will take a look on the commands that Interreg uses. And because it just makes sense that you understand the commands that Interreg uses, so you can also understand the script files. Let's start with a typical installation script recorded with Interreg. This one that you see here. So this is what it's doing. Oh, it makes the uninstallation. And let's now take a look on the commands and go step by step through it. So, I make a new script that we can use to test the commands. So the first command name is NUA if not user is admin. It does mean. So mbx I am not admin else mbx I am admin. It's so simple. So now let's format the script and run it. And I save it on the desktop in my project as a test script. So, and you see, I am not admin. So this editor, which starts when I double click the script, is not started as administrator. That's why I get I am not admin. If I close the editor, and I go here and I start SPR editor for installations and I run this, I will get I am admin. So this now starts the script as administrator. Sometimes, especially with automated installations, this really makes sense. So that's the first command. Not user admin is just a question, is the user that who starts the script admin or not, and he needs to be admin to make automated installations normally. So the next we have done ourselves, this is the if application installed. So again, we can test it here. Let's take the, okay, we need to install it quickly. So it's installed. Now we can test this. You can type the point and then choose it just here. MBX, it's installed. Doppelpunkt, dollar, dollar, 1, 2, 3. So let's see what we get. Yeah, we have two endif. Because I wrote one and one was automatically inserted now. So it's installed. Irfan View 4.56 32 Bit. So you not need the complete description. You can also just test for a part of it. And as you can see, you get on the top of stack the precise name of the installed software. Let's see what's there additionally, or if there is something additionally on the stack. Oh no, the stack is empty, okay. So, if you ask with ERE and you give him something, even if it's just a letter, in this case we get the first one he found is Microsoft Visual C++ Additional Runtime. If I write ERF, we get it's installed, Irfan you, blah, blah, blah. So again with ERE, you can use the standard search pattern. So where do we have the standard search pattern? Inhalt, components, special features, system variables. Here is the standard search pattern. You can use all these patterns for example, you could say IRF und or Doppelpunkt fan, which doesn't make sense, but you can do it. Or we can say Microsoft oder fan. Now we will get what first? We get the Microsoft runtime. So if we make it in the other way, if I say fan v from Irfan view or mic, we'll again get Microsoft because it's just the first who is fitting into this. So if I don't use mic here, but maybe int from Intel, we get Irfan view is now the next one he finds. So it's also a question, the first one he gets, the first one you will get here. So you can use standard search pattern. Let's take a bit on a quick look on tolerant, which is also funny. So it uses a percentage scale of 0 to 100. So we can say ihr phone and we say 80%, and he didn't find it. Let's say 30%. If I say ihr fan, so now he found it. You see, with 30% tolerance, he will find it because the name, of course, is much longer. If I say 80%, he will not find it anymore. So he found it. Of course, it's there. It doesn't even need the tolerance. But now you can say, for example, 4.12, so which is another version, and he found it anyway because we have a tolerance of 70%. We can even maybe go up to 90%. He will find it. If we go very high with the tolerance to 99%, he doesn't find it because this is more than 99% if he has to change it. So even 95 will not work. So fuzzy logic, you can even use fuzzy logic here in this. So you see, will also be found. So you have several options here with the standard search patterns. And this is what we have done here with the if application installed. And to make the opposite, if you want to know if it's not installed, you will just change the E to an N, and then it's not installed. So of course the stack doesn't make any sense in this case. So it's not installed. N-A-E. So this is this one. Now this command is not used by InstaRec. We have used it in the installation script. It's a gosub. So this means the script jumps to this label until he comes to a return, and then he will come back where he comes from and go into the next line. This is here. From here he goes here and ends the script. So we will jump, if IrfanView is installed, we will jump to uninstallation, to this label, which is here. And then we will start with the script, and this is the first line. And this is the error code. So var, we define the variable $$pro and we give it the value of 20,001. At the same time, this is the error code that you will get if in the next block would be an error and would make him a jump to the on error label. So let me see if we have something on error. Error codes. The global and local stack on error label. Yeah, here we have it. The on error label is a special label. On error is a special label. It's not a label like any other. Because on error does not prevent error messages. You have to use the USM command, but on error is called if there is an error in the script. Assume an error occurs and there is such a label in a script, then the robot will continue script execution with on error label. The error message will still be displayed unless you use the USM10 command, but you can tell the script how to deinitialize or do whatever. So if you have the on error label, in case of error, the robot will bring the error message and then go here. And this is why we use the on error label here. In case of any error, the script will jump there and the variable $$pro will have the number from the last block where, for example, the window typically was not found or where the error happened. So this is the variable $$pro and the on error label. So next we have here the command that will start the uninstall program, for example. Fragezeichen procs, by the way, is a special folder. You see it here in special folders when you press the F1 button. And Fragezeichen procs is the special folder for C program files, the 32-bit special program folder. There is another one that's called Programs 64 here, and this is C program files. So, and then we have the command exe. This will just call this uninstall exe from the IrfanView program folder. It will also deliver the process ID. That's why we have here this. If the var is there, it's okay. If it's not there, the robot will transparently write it here. So this is just the same as if I would write var ist. So it's the same. So we could also remove it here. Technically, this is the same. Just variable ist gleich number or process ID from the Excel in this case. Let me first uninstall the Irfan view. And run the Irfan view setup. So we will use this as a target. So assume the robot should be told to click a button. Clear all marks. So the robot should be told to click, for example, this weiter button. How do I tell the robot this? First, I need to tell him which window I like. So I want this Irfan view window, and then I want this button in that window. There may be other windows with also a button with this name, but we want just this window and this button. To do this, what we say is stv search top window, locate the application window. And then we must describe the application window so the robot knows which one we want. I could simply say T text pipe. Now comes the text. So this only tells the robot what comes is the text. And then I could say Irfan exactly what is up here, or apart from what is up here, Irfan view. So it's very simple. I told him this is the text, and the text is Irfan view. And if I now make a mouse move, watch what happens. We are going directly into the middle point of the window with the mouse. So he found the window, and we're going the middle. If you locate a window, always the middle point of the window is being located. So now we can not only, we could have theoretically more windows with Irfan view. So for safety, we always use a second parameter. Mostly Interact uses more parameters, and that is the so-called window class. The window class you see here in the window inspector, the first thing here is the window class. So if I drive here, you see we have a window class of 32,717. So what I do is, what I could do is, I could also say C and where do I drive? At the exactly same point, because this is also this window. Now I could have more windows with this class also. So what I do is I tell him, okay, I give you first the text and then I give you the class. Irfan. So I give both, and then he will check if both are valid and drive there. So this is generally how the STV works. Now if we look in the install Irfan view setup, you will see here that we have more parameters, not only C and T, but we have also V, that is the waiting time, how long he will wait before an error message comes, and we have the H. And now let's see what the H makes. For this, I will just press F1 to get into the help, and then I can press here H. And then you see H flag primary desktop. This flag will move the window to position 00, that is the upper left corner. If the window is full or partially outside the primary desktop work area. So if the H is specified and the window is here, it's moved up there. As an alternative, you could specify, for example, an A. And the A prevents the Windows processing. So you see, if I have an A there, the the window just stays at the place. If I use an H, it will be set to 0,0, which we do in automated installation because it's just better. Additionally, we have a waiting time, which I will show you now. This is the W parameter. And then I need here a pipe and let's say 1 second. Now what I do, now in normal, nothing else will change. It will just work. So now I will do a mistake. I will write an X here and we don't have an Irfan X window. So he will not find the window. Now look what happens. You will get an error message. Script name, window not found in time. And the time is 1 second. I can even choose a 0. And you get the error message immediately. If I choose a 5, he will wait 5 seconds for the window to come up. And if it doesn't come up, you get the error message. And as said, you can still specify the on error label. And now I will make this back to 0 and let's see. Okay, I press abbrechen. Ah, that's why. So if I press cancel, he will run into the on error, as you see here. If I press wiederholen, also continue, he will just continue the script. So that's why you get this error message with two choices. You can say cancel and then he will run into the on error. So that is the prototype parameter system. In case you want to see more information about this, there is an explanation also in the help file, especially about the prototype parameters. Here, you see by C also 1.4 the prototype parameter system. So here it's explained again in detail what is a parameter, how is it specified in color, even more complicated cases. So in short, those letters here define what the rest here is. This is necessary because alternatively you would have a lot of parameters for everything and a lot of pipes when if you don't use the parameter. So now we have the window. We don't have the button yet. Now let's see if we get the button also. To get the button inside the window, the command is scv, search child window. Somehow search button. And theoretically, I can just write text. The next comes is text. And then I write weiter. And then he should move here. We will see that. And by the way, you may wonder, the mouse is not driving straight but in curves, like it's drunken. This is the so-called human mouse move. You can tell the robot if you want a human mouse move and to what degree. So, human mouse move, for example, what can I do here? 0 off and 45 is very strong. So that was really strong. Okay, and 0. Okay, now you see it's a straight line like other robots, but our robot is like a human, so we take 25. And the reason for this is there may be programs who detect if you are a robot or not. And if you use the smart package robot human mouse move, no computer will easily detect if this mouse was moved by a human or it was moved by a robot. So that's why we have the human mouse move. So, up till I want to test something. What if I take 125? Is he completely drunken then? Haha, look. Then the mouse will drive like this. It definitely not a computer movement then. So, also the human mouse move. For easiness, we will just take a 5 here. It looks nice. So, this means this way you can locate the button on which you click, for example, or where you drive. SCW and T weiter. And the same applies also with the window class. We have here the window class button. So I can say this is a button. Button. So it doesn't change anything about the script. It will just specify more exactly what I want. The reason is, if there would be the word weiter somewhere in the text, also, if I just give the text and not the window class, the mouse may drive there. For example, we see here the program. So I will now remove the button again, and as text I write proker. That's enough. So, and now you see he found here the program files, and that's where he goes. He goes to the text field, and he goes to the middle, to the center of the text field. So using the STW, you locate the element, and then you can make a mouse move, or you can make a mouse click. In this case, I will make a double click, and this will make him to mark the word like this. So these are the most often used commands. These commands do have special features. I just want to show you one. For example, if I say there is a button and it's not there, of course I will get an error message like before, and that's why I tell him don't wait longer than 0 seconds. So you see, here's the error message, this button cannot be found. Now what can I do? I can do a small o on not found go to. This means I can also add here an o and say not found, and which is a label, and then I can say here end. So let's start it, and you see he doesn't find the window, and he immediately jumps to not found and brings me this message. In the same way, I can do some to the opposite. I can choose another primitive and say, if it's found, where is it? Count on level, g. Here, go to on found. So this is the opposite of the O, is the G. So I can say G, on found, go to found. So I can say found. Doppelpunkt found. So that's funny, because I don't know which one he will now really take. It doesn't matter, because if the window is there, he will take the found. I remove the X, because now he will find the window, and now you see he will go to found. It's not the G, it's the, let me see. Here we have a complete list. Here, goes up on not found, goes up on found. It's the large V, that is goes up on found. So, also, I replace the G with the large V. And then we have it. He will jump return and make the double click. So this is how you must read the most used InstaRec commands, the SCB and the STV. And now let's take a look on the mouse clicks. That's the next thing. That's important. The InstaRec uses a lot of different mouse clicks. So to make this easier, we will just make a simple SCBT weiter. And nein, I will exit this. Yeah. To do this, it's better I use a sample application because otherwise the button will disappear. So Dateipfad öffnen. We have sample applications for this. For example, here this test app 01. It has a lot of possibilities where you can click. So, and I will just record button 2 for me. And if you record with the editor, which is still a little bit lousy implemented, but I'm working on it, you will get always also a lot of mouse coordinates. You can remove them. This is just for the case of nothing else works. So, and now we will make a direct engine click. This is the normal MLE. So you see, you have pressed button 2, but the mouse doesn't go there. So while the mouse is here, the robot still clicks that button. That's why it's the direct engine. You can see it in the help file here. If you see the direct engine logo, it's the direct engine mouse click. And you see here in the help file, mouse operations, all the mouse clicks, and some of them are used, especially the automated clicks are used with the InstaRec also. And these clicks are both direct engine or compatible engine or even mixed. And so that's why they have no logo. So that's number one. Now number two is the mouse left click invisible. Now look what happens. So this is not easy to see, but the mouse left click invisible is a compatible engine click. It's a real mouse click. The point is that the mouse jumps there and jumps immediately back, so you don't see it. But that's why it's called invisible, but it's a real mouse click. So if you check the help file on it, you will see it has the green symbol for compatible engine. Here. This is the compatible engine, not as fast, but it always works. So it has also a lot of options. So mouse left click invisible, and then we have the normal mouse click, the real mouse click. So the one that will also use the human mouse move if you tell it to do so. He's driving there with the mouse and he is clicking on this. So that is the human mouse move. MLC, the normal mouse move. If you're not sure what to use and if nothing works, try this one. It will not nearly always work. So then we have one more mouse move that's a combination. This one is, I don't think the InstaRec really uses it. This is, if you have tried the MLE, so InstaRec may use the MLI, and if it doesn't work for whatever reason, then you can try before you use the slow MLC, you can try the MLM. This is a special mouse move. It's also compatible engine, and it will make the mouse jump here, make a small movement over the button, and then click. So it's a bit tricky. You see? He will go there, make a small mouse movement, and then click. Of course, you will not see much, but this is very compatible and nearly as fast as the mouse left click invisible. So InstaRec will also record a mouse right click. If you do one, that is the right click. And nothing happens here because there are no menus, unless you go to this, for example. And if I make a, let me see if I can make a 266, which shouldn't work normally. It works. You have the 266 here. If you want to do this manually, it may not work because you cannot enter more than 255, but the direct engine can even set it to 299. So that's the advantage of the direct engine. The direct engine can also click on deactivated buttons, by the way. We can do that later, possibly. You try it yourself with using the right options here. Let's assume we want to take insert, but we have nothing valid in the clipboard. So let's make a clipboard operation. This is none of the commands that the InstaRec uses, but we can, let's say, 100. And we make SMH. Let me see if the help file supports what I want to do. So let's try. Yeah, we did it. We inserted the 100 here, you see. Now, I don't think this will go with the 399, because this way it doesn't work, but we will try. 399. So this is working. So I can take the 399, go here and press string V, and he will insert the 399. So this way you can trick those IP controls, possibly. So this is if you wanna use a right click, for example, to work with a menu. This is then the menu stuff here. But now I want to show you the automated mouse clicks, and this is the BSC and the BCS. So first, if I do nothing, let's see what happens. So you have pressed button 1. This means he has pressed button 1 one time. Now I will reverse the letters and make a BCS. Now you see he's instantly pressing button 1. I must stop him violently, because you see he presses a lot button 1. I will clear this so you see it again. So you see he's pressing, because the BCS will press until the window disappears. Which doesn't happen here. So the BCS is will click button, click special, will click until it disappears. The BSC will do something else depending on the parameters. He is okay if the text of the button changes or if something in the form changes. So the BCS will click and then wait a short time. Next, the target button as well as the target window is checked for a reaction to the mouse click. If there is no reaction, BSC will click again until there is a reaction. So If we use BSC here, you will see he will just click one time, because we have here a reaction. This says you have pressed button one, and the BSC sees, okay, there's a reaction, I can stop clicking. There are additional parameters. This means you can tell the BSC how to click. You can, for example, you can also click until top window disappears. You can say the button must become invisible or disabled. You can say button must become disabled. Button text must change. These are the, and you can choose which mouse click. Also, if you want direct engine, compatible engine, you can close the window. You can MLM. And you can MLM and MLE are used. So this is an intelligent button click, and InstaRec likes to use this one. So these are the special, the automated mouse clicks, BSC and BCS. They are the one the InstaRec is using. There are other mouse clicks the InstaRec is not using. This one I would like to try if it works. Mouse, yeah. Oh yeah, he really do it. Look. We will check here the check one. So I will say SCWT. Check 1. Okay. And then I want this to be checked. You see, it's checked. If I run the script again, it will stay checked. If I say I don't want it to be checked, I must make this a 0, and then it will be unchecked. Even if I run it again, it will be unchecked. So BTC will definitely check or uncheck the button. If it doesn't work with 0 and 1, you have the option to use 2 and 3. In this case, 3 will not check it, and 2 will check it. So using the compatible engine. This means if I use 2 times, it will also switch the state. With 3, it doesn't work. If I use 2, and then 3, it will always be unchecked. And we have even 4, I think. Will check it. Okay, also the most important are 1 and 2. 1 will set the checkmark, and 0 will remove the checkmark. Let me take a look in the help file. Button check. So nothing should be. So the button check is whether compatible engine or direct engine, depending if you use 1 and 0 is direct engine, and 4 and 3 is compatible engine. Besides that, you have the option to use the 6 with the mouse and uncheck with the 7. So you have also 6 and 7. And then there will be a mouse move. 6. So, and 7. Yeah, 7. And if it's checked already, he will not do anything. And with 6, he will remove the check mark. So, That's the button check command, while InstaRec will mostly use 0 and 1, if I remember right. So then we have set foreground window. This is just setting the foreground window, it's nothing special. So generally this is automatically done within the stv and stv command, so it's not really needed. This is just an additional safety for the script, so nothing else. It will bring the window to the foreground. And here we have jump on variable. So this is a conditional jump. It will take the variable $$pro, and if it's not zero, which it was set here, if you come regularly without an error here, it's zero because you run over this line. And then it's zero and you will just send the return code zero, no error. And if $$pro is not zero, this means you came over this label, which is the on error label we had before. And this means it's not zero. This is the condition not zero. And then he will jump to error handler. Error handler is here. And here he will do anything that is done in case of error and also report you the error from the block number as a return code for your executable. He will also try to make a screenshot and also save it, which may not work on a private desktop. I don't know, I didn't test it finally. So that is mostly all the code that's used by InstaRec. I don't think it's much more. Here down here in the we have not exist file, we have if variable value, but this is the runtime section, so it's not really the section that is the code that is generated. The generated code is rather simple and is mostly the window commands with the parameters. And you have all sorts of button clicks. This is what InstaRec records. And the rest is done here, the runtime, which generates a log file in case of error. Here's one thing you need to know. We have replace selected text command with the $$s00. And the $$s00 is the content of a text file, and you will find it at the start of the script, defined. Where is it? It's here with the installation. Here. $$s00 is gleich, and this is the path where the program is going to be installed. This means if you change it here, it will be changed in the setup when it runs automatically. So one more command we have, I saw it, and this is the parallel running robot. So now we had this before, but I will explain it shortly. Normally when you make a setup, you just click next, 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 weiter, 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 and like this. And now it happens that there comes a pop-up. Here we end it. This is our pop-up. It will be started by a parallel running robot. And so the first thing is I start it. I need to make a one here. So this one is necessary for the box not to disappear because I need to record it. I now press a P for pop-up. I go to OK and record it. So that's all. Now I can format the code. And now what I got is You may wonder why I get this, but what I got is just this line here, which looks like the line the InstaRec has generated. So now take a look on this line. We have the do button click, and here we have the text from the message box, which says I am an error. The dollar SP dollar is just a space. So, and then we have here a one, which means he should click on it. And here is the window class. This is the window class from the pop-up. That's all. Now, let me change this. I make three of them. Now, I run the script slowly. Nothing happens. Now we started the parallel robot, and you see immediately the three pop-ups have been clicked. Now look again. Really fast. And the point is, I can even make more of them. So let's say 100. So we have now 300 pop-ups that will come one after the other. And we give the robot 10 seconds time for that. So the pop-up parallel running robot is really fast. You see he's clicking them very quickly. And this was 300. So what we're doing here is we start a robot in parallel who will always watch until such a message comes. Look, if I run here, the message comes. And if the message comes, he will click it quickly. I cannot click it quickly enough, so. That's why we have the do button click robot. He can quickly click it. So let me remove the check mark and now see it again. So you see the do button click will, and no matter where the pop-up comes, anywhere in the script the pop-up comes, he will click it. So that is the dbc command. I recommend that you experiment a little bit with it. It's a very nice thing, and also very nice for scripting, weil the InstaRec doesn't use it, is the option to use parallel running robots. We have here a parallel running button click robot, and here we use the parallel robot to make the 300 message boxes. Let me take a look if there is something more. I think that's all. That should be all the instructions the InstaRec is using, and it's not really much. If you know these that I have shown you in this video, you should be able to understand easily all the things that InstaRec is doing. And the power of parallel running robots. Of course, you can also do that yourself. You must not use the parallel robots that are already delivered. You can also formulate your own ones here that run in a loop while the setup is running and wait for windows and click on them. So you can do all this stuff yourself. InstaRec currently uses only the button clicker robots. So far about this second video on the InstaRec, and see you in the next video.